Thank you. Good morning, and welcome to our time of worship on this 18th Sunday after Pentecost, World Communion Sunday. Welcome to new visitors and old friends. Welcome to all who have no church home, need strength, want to follow Christ, have doubts, or do not believe. Welcome to grandparents, to mothers, fathers, and single people. Welcome to people of all colors, cultures, abilities, of all sexual orientations, gender identities, and gender expression, to old and to young, to believers and to questioners, and welcome to questioning believers. Welcome to everyone, no matter who you are, whom you love, or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And we hope that you find this time of worship to bring uplift and peace in your life. We have a few announcements for you this morning. The first is, as I mentioned, this is World Communion Sunday. And I hope that you were all able to stop by the church earlier in the week to pick up one of our individually sealed pre-consecrated communion cups. And if you did so, now is the time to go ahead and open that up and get it ready for communion, which will happen later in the service. Note that there's a little wafer on top. You can peel off the top layer and access that. And then there's another little layer you peel off to get to the juice in the cup. And note that these are gluten-free wafers and this is alcohol-free juice so that all can partake. And as it is a Communion Sunday, you will be happy to know that my tradition on Communion Sundays is to preach a little bit less. So I can already see the fist pumps going, the high fives in your household happening. So today is your lucky day. We will have a shorter sermon. However, I'm very happy to say that we'll have a kids message. And then I will invite our children to head out to their children's program, which will be led by Miss Heidi, happening on Zoom. So that will be happening a little bit later in the worship service. So we're hopeful that you as a family can join us together for the first portion of worship before the kids head out and go to their separate activities. So one other item I want to share with you, this is sad news in the life of our church, and that is that our dear friend Carol Paulus is in hospice care now in Danvers. So please be sure to keep Carol and her family in your prayers, lifting them up to God, asking for strength as Carol continues on her journey and in these last days of her earthly journey. Pray that she would be blessed and be surrounded by the love of her church family as well as her family as she is in hospice care. I want to thank folks who are helping me in worship today, Deacon Judy Clark, Music Director Joyce Simpson. We are blessed to have the vocal support of Dick Perry today, and our camera operator is Christine McGarry. And now let us continue in the worship with this morning's call to worship.
Good morning. Please join me in the responsive call to worship. The God who frees us invites us to worship. The God of law welcomes our loyal response. The heavens are telling of the glory of God. The firmament proclaims God's handiwork. God is present with us, eager to speak to us. Our Creator is here to test us and to keep us from sin. The law of God is perfect, reviving the soul. God's decrees are sure, making wise the simple. We tremble before God, yet we are not afraid. We are ready to listen to God's word. May our awe before God be pure and enduring. May our thoughts and our words be acceptable to God.
In our unison prayer of invocation, please join me in offering this prayer to God. O God, our rock and our redeemer, enlighten us today through the ancient witness of your faithful people. Lead us to desire the guidance of your word. Remind us of your ordinances that are true and righteous altogether. May they shape our living and warn us when we are in error. We seek to honor your name, to divest ourselves of idols, to keep this day of rest and worship. Work with us to develop right relationships in our families and with all your children near and far. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And please join us in song now. We'll sing together our first hymn, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is. Let us move to our time of confession. We are tenants to whom God has leased some of the earth's wealth. God comes among us to collect what we have produced, to claim a portion of all that is God's own. Our Creator seeks an accounting of our faithfulness to the way of life designed for us. Let us seek together forgiveness for our shortcomings. And please join us now in our unison prayer of confession, as together we pray. O God, we have no righteousness of our own. We have bent and ignored your law. Your commandments inform us, but do not transform. We say we embrace your law, but then seek to avoid its implications for our lives. We recognize some of our errors, but many are hidden from us. We devote our energies to accumulating possessions that function as idols in our lives. We depend on them more than we honor you. Save us, we pray, from great transgressions, and help us to reorder days. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, for God has come only to test you and to put the fear of God upon you so that you do not sin. The one who orders all worlds seeks to bring order and joyous freedom into our lives. Fear God. And to fear God is to open our eyes to the amazing vastness of God's dominion and to the astonishing awareness that God knows each of us, loves us, and has a purpose for us. Let God reign among us. Amen. And normally I would invite the children to come forward and join me on the floor, but as you are hanging out at home, you can kind of stay seated right where you're at. I do have a message for you, though. Today in church, we're learning about how God calls us to be a vineyard. And what in the world is a vineyard? Well, I'm sure many of you have been to farms. Maybe you've seen corn growing in a farm, or you've seen maybe other things growing. Well, a farm that grows grapes is called a vineyard. And there were many places that grew grapes where Jesus lived. And so oftentimes in the Bible, the people of God are described as God's vineyard. Just like grapes planted by God, the vines grow up and they produce fruit. And so Jesus said that we were God's vineyard and that we are to produce fruit. And what kind of fruit are we to produce? Can we grow grapes? Do little apples spring out of our fingers? Maybe bananas? Well, probably not. But there are some wonderful things that can grow in us and through us. The Bible says some of these are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And there are so many other wonderful fruits that can be produced by our lives. And so we are God's vineyard, God's garden, and we make these wonderful fruits. They live in us so that we can give wonderful fruits to the world around us. Just like a grape is a tasty little treat that is wonderful to consume, the fruits that we produce are tasty treats for the world. The world needs love. The world needs peace. The world needs patience. The world needs kindness and goodness. All the gifts of God come to the world, and they come through our work. So let us produce the fruits of God so that the world can be made much more tasty. Let's pray. God, we thank you for blessing us this day, for calling us to be your people, to bring goodness to the world. Help us to do just that, to let fruits come out of us so that the people in the world can be blessed and the world can be made much more wonderful. Help us to do that this day. We pray in the name of Christ. Amen. And now our children are dismissed for their activities as we continue in worship with the hearing of God's word.
The first reading is from Exodus chapter 20. Then God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slaves, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor.
And our reading from the Gospels today comes to us from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 21. Listen for the word of God. Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance." So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do with those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death, and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone'? This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produce the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them, and they wanted to arrest him. But they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. These words are breathed into us by the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God.
And he walks with me.
There once was a young paratrooper who was learning the trade, was up in an airplane, and the sergeant, when it was time for the trooper to jump out of the airplane, gave some instructions. The sergeant said to the paratrooper, "There are four rules. One, when I say jump, you need to move to the end of the plane and jump out of it. Number two, once you're out of the plane, pull the ripcord. Three, if the parachute fails to open, pull the emergency ripcord. Four, when you get down to the ground, find the jeep that will take you back to the base." Easy enough, four rules. So the paratrooper followed rule number one. When the sergeant said move to the back of the plane and jump, the paratrooper did. And as the paratrooper was plummeting towards the earth, pulled the ripcord, unfortunately, the parachute didn't open. And so the paratrooper had to enact rule number three and pull the emergency ripcord. Unfortunately, that parachute did not open either. And so as the paratrooper was plummeting toward the earth, he said to himself, "Oh great, and I suppose the jeep won't be down there either." Well, sometimes when we follow the rules in life, it doesn't always work out perfectly, even though we think it should. Today we're going to be talking about rules, the rules of life, and how they can help us as we move forward together. Please pray with me. Oh God, take our minds and think through them, take our lips and speak through them, and take our hearts and set them on fire. Amen. Well, in today's reading from the book of Exodus, we were given 10 rules, or I should say Moses was given 10 rules, to give to the people of Israel. And these 10 rules were foundational for the people. They were part of the original deal that God had made with them. The deal was they would become God's people, no longer Pharaoh's people, that God would set them free from their bondage and take them to their own land. But the people's part of the deal was they had to follow these 10 rules of God. And they weren't negotiable. These were essential to who they were as a people. And all of these rules that they were given, all 10 of them, were designed to help them relationally. These were rules between people and God and people and one another. These were rules that were given so that people had boundaries to help them in their relationships and to increase life and love within those boundaries. Brevard Childs, a longtime professor of Old Testament at Yale University, said this about these commandments. He said they serve not only to chart the outer boundary, but to provide positive content for life within the circle of this covenant. The commandments look both outward and inward. They guard us against the way of death, and they point to the way of life. I really like that phrase. They guard against the way of death, and they point to the way of life. And that is exactly what these commandments do, and truly all of God's rules for us. They point to the way of life and to the way of love. These, my friends, are the rules of the vineyard. They were the rules for Israel, and these are rules for us together as a people to this day. They are rules for an expanded vineyard of God that includes the church. These rules can really be summed up in this. God wants for us more life and more love. And it's good for us to have these guidelines because we know that the journey of life can be quite messy, and we need help sometimes identifying what it is that God wants for us. Life and love. Remember the lesson of the paratrooper? Sometimes when we follow these lessons, these rules for us, even then things don't work out perfectly. It'd be a lot easier if life were simple, if there were blacks and whites, if there were endless shades of gray that we have to live with. But that is exactly what we have. Many, many different shades of gray. One of the differences between progressive Christians, as we are in the United Church of Christ, and some of the more conservative Christian traditions, is that we emphasize that there is an infinite set of grayness, and that we are always needing to discern God's still speaking voice so that we know how to live in ways that please God and serve others. Whereas our more conservative siblings really have more of a black and white approach to things, which you can do if you take the Bible literally. Do this and you're in. Do that and you're out. A simple set of rules. But my own experience has led me to believe that that doesn't always work out so well. We can follow the letter of the law, but in so doing, miss the entire meaning of the law and miss the grace that God provides for us in the rules that we have been provided. Jesus did this very thing on his Sermon on the Mount. He took the law that was given by Moses to the people, and he kicked it up a few notches and said, don't just take this by the letter, but by the Spirit. So the instruction to not kill the other, Jesus expanded to read, don't kill, not even with your words. And the restriction that we read against adultery, Jesus increased to this, don't commit adultery even in your thoughts. Jesus kicked up the teachings of God to make them relevant for us at all times and places, to help make them living so that they can truly help us in every aspect of our being. So we have to ask ourselves in each moment of each day, what increases life and love in our lives? What increases life and love in my own life? And do that. That's the law of God. That's the rule of God for you. And we need to follow this rule to increase life and love because our world needs more life and more love. We need more dignity being expressed to people. We need to see more acts of civility between people. Case in point, perhaps you watched the presidential debate earlier in the week. And since I'm already talking about religion, I might as well talk about politics too. What could go wrong? Well, we know if you did have the pleasure of watching the debate, you saw that there were a lot of interruptions, and it was not the most civil conversation between people. In fact, there were 93 interruptions between the two candidates. 71 of these interruptions was by one candidate in particular. I won't tell you who that is. In case you haven't watched it yet, I don't want to be a spoiler, but I'm sure you can guess who the chief interrupter was. But the debate overall was far from civil. It was far from dignified. It wasn't really a debate at all, but devolved into something of a debacle. CNN's Jake Tapper described it as a disgrace because of its incivility. Truly, it was quite chaotic and pretty ugly. And it all happened because the characters involved disregarded the rules. The rules that were designed to protect the conversation and provide for it to be fruitful. Well, that didn't happen. Sometimes when you disregard the rules, chaos ensues and destruction. This is a good lesson for us. And let it not be this way for us in God's vineyard. Let us follow the rules that lead to us treating each other with more civility and with more dignity. Because this is God's rule of furthering life and love. And this is our challenge this day, to continue our lives together in ways that increase the dignity of one another and the connection between us. And especially, increase these connections between those of us who differ in some ways. Think about the forbidden topic of politics that I just brought up, and our topic of religion. You know, at the Thanksgiving dinner, you're not supposed to talk about these things, and then the other one, money. Of course, we always do anyway, and all kinds of craziness ensues. Well, we should be mindful of our conversation at the Thanksgiving dinner table and in every place, and especially in this place of the church, so that we do not have conversation that creates division. And another good thing we can keep in mind is to say no to Schadenfreude, which is a good German word, and perhaps you've read about this. Merriam-Webster online has said there's been a 30,000% increase in people who have been looking up that German word, Schadenfreude, this week. And it means taking pleasure in someone else's misfortune or their suffering. My guess, the increase in the search for this word is due to the fact that our U.S. president and many around him have become ill with COVID-19, many of whom weren't always following the guidelines related to keeping one another safe with our face masks. But I think God calls us to say no to Schadenfreude, even towards the rule flaunters, towards one another, especially towards those with whom we differ. Remember, God is gracious. We should be gracious. God is merciful. Let us be merciful. This is the way of life and love in the vineyard of God. And let us share this way with the world around us. This, friends, is part of our extravagant welcome. We say here that all are welcome. We say that no matter who you are, whom you love, or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Even if you have four legs, you are welcome here. We know that yesterday, many of us were gathered outside of the church for a blessing of the animals. There were 24 humans and a variety of pets. We had a few dogs and Binks the cat. And up in the trees above us were plenty of squirrels. They were wisely staying away from the dogs and the cat. But we were all one congregation, one happy congregation. Difference. We came from different places, we were different species even, but we united our voices and our yelps in praise to God. This is who we are. We are people who bring all of God's creatures together. And when we gather together as God's children, we do so with a united voice, even though we are different in many ways. We come from near and far as a worldwide vineyard of God. We celebrate this especially this day, on World Communion Sunday, as we gather together with God's current vineyard of 2.4 billion Christians living around the world, making up about a third of the world's population. We know that we're different in many ways. We worship God in different ways. We follow the rules of God in different ways. But today we are united, in celebrating God's grace, God's mercy, and God's presence in our lives in this gift of Holy Communion. We are truly one vineyard. So this day, dear friends, let us be good vines, producing fruit as God calls us to do, increasing in life and love ourselves, and then sharing life and love with others. Let us be good stewards of God's vineyard as we grow within it. Let us increase life and love, for these are the vineyard rules. May they guide us this day. Amen. And now please join us in our second hymn, Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us. Now we move to a time where we lift up our joys and our concerns to God in prayer. If you have any joys or concerns, you can put those into the chat window right now if you're on Facebook Live, and we can include those in the morning prayers. As you're adding your prayers, we'll begin our time of prayer with a moment for silent meditation. Holy One, Creator of all, we lift up our siblings around the world. We have heard their cries for justice and peace as they face challenges. We pray for our siblings who are suffering, those experiencing abuse to their rights, those suffering from damage to the creation, and those hurting from COVID-19. We reflect now upon the news of the world and speak into the silence the names of areas or countries where there is a deep need in this moment. No God, we know that there are many obstacles to addressing these great challenges. But we also know that you are greater, and that your love for your people is deeper than we could ever imagine. Cover your people, your vineyard, with your love, O God. May we feel your presence walking with us each day. Guide us, O God, that we may also walk beside our local and global neighbors in prayer, partnership, and presence. May we listen to you and our partners as we consider what we might do to share in the ministry with all people. And now we pause to reflect upon the news of the world, which gives us expressions of unexpected hope. You can speak into the silence the names of places or people where you've witnessed God being joyously revealed. O God, weave us together in hope that we may recognize that we are all part of your great tapestry. All of our threads are needed and necessary for your beautiful design. Strengthen us and nourish us for the journey. We pray for strength and nourishment to come to those in need of healing this day, O God. For Kathy and Aurora as they recover from surgeries. We pray this for Donald's family and all those dealing with COVID-19. And we pray for peace to be with those who love them. We pray for wisdom to be with our leaders, that they would work together to keep us safe and secure, and that they would work to provide and protect our people. We pray for strength to be with Beth as she is considering surgery before her. We pray for peace to be with Carol and her family as she is on the last steps of her journey in hospice care. O God, we ask for your blessing to be on the lives of all who gathered here yesterday, even our four-legged friends. Bless all of our pets, all of the creatures of the world, with goodness on this day. Bless us all, we pray. May we be filled with the knowledge of your goodness living in us, that we may be filled with joy. It's the name of Christ that we come before you, offering all these prayers. Amen. Friends, God has planted a vineyard on this tiny planet that we call home. This earth has been blessed with great resources that have been entrusted to our care. What is produced by our caretaking is not our own, but is rightfully claimed by God for the benefit of all people. It is the fruit of God's realm that we share today. We thank you for continuing your contributions to your church, even at this time, knowing that your church is actively at work blessing the world around us with food and the gift of life in many ways. So thank you for your gifts to God by giving to the church.
Thank you.
Let us pray together our unison prayer of dedication. Ruler of all space and time, we want to be faithful stewards in your vineyard. All that we have is yours. Our lives are in your hands. Help us to use well all that we here devote to the work of your church. Help us to manage well, to your honor and glory, all that we retain for ourselves. May we know heaven on earth because you hold first place in our priorities, and our daily goal is to serve you. Amen. Remembering that many of us are gathered remotely this day at many tables, and we are sharing bread and the cup in a virtual communion, may we remember that this action at the table is the ultimate symbol of our unity with one another and with God. This table is set, and all of our tables are set to recognize that we are God's children and that we are welcome. These tables are open, and all of God's children receive grace, love, and hope through them. This welcome, this bounty, this experience of God's saving love is celebrated here at this table and all around the world. Know that this is an open table, and all who know Christ living within them or want to know Christ's presence are welcome to join us in this fellowship.
Whiter than snow?
God be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to God Most High. Let us pray. This prayer from Bangladesh on this World Communion Sunday. O Savior Christ, in whose way of life lies the secret of all life and the hopes of all people, we pray for quiet courage to meet this hour. We did not choose to be born or to live in such an age, but let its problem challenge us, its discoveries exhilarate us, its injustices anger us, its possibilities inspire us, its vigor renew us for your kingdom's sake. O God, bless this cup and bread that it may nourish us for the journey. Together in hope, we pray. Amen. We remember on the night of betrayal that Jesus took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body for you. As often as you take of it, do so in remembrance me." Likewise, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Drink of it, all of you, And as often as you do so, do it in remembrance of me. Friends, as often as we consume the bread and drink of the cup, we proclaim Christ's life, that Christ rose again, and that Christ will come. Ministering to you in the name of Christ, I offer you the bread of heaven. Let us consume now the gift of God. And I offer to you the cup of salvation. Let us offer together our unison prayer of thanksgiving. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the gift of our Savior's presence in the simplicity and splendor of this holy meal. Unite us with all who are fed by Christ's body and blood, that we may faithfully proclaim the good news of your love, and that your universal church may be a rainbow of hope in an uncertain world, through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. And we pray this even as together we pray the Lord's Prayer, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now let us offer our final hymn, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee.
Thank you. And as our service in this room has come to an end, your service to the world outside continues. And may God, who is our creator, redeemer, and sustainer, be with you this day and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.